Well, to use the string class, the header file that you need is a string. So first, the constructors. There's a bunch of them, but the basic one, I guess, is string s1, hello world, s1. So here we have hello world. And there's a bunch of them, so this is C++.com. Oh, put it here. Yeah, that's about right, okay. It's a bunch of constructors here. And C++ 11, okay. So I just use this one. But you can this is a substring class constructor, so that's the other one that might be useful. So string s2, you can make it s1, right? So hello world here again. Now to make a substring, I guess the so a substring here. There's a position, there's a length. The length defaults to and position, like end position is like the longest position. So if I do 3, so 0 is the H, 1 is the E, 2, 3, 3 is the L, okay? So this will get a low world, or should be something like that. So it starts at LO. Now if I want just 4 characters, I guess I'll give it the length argument I left out. So this gives stat. So another one is that might be useful. Not quite sure. You can do a bunch of repeating characters, I guess. So if 10A, this will give you a string that has 10 A's in it. So do this. Oh no, launch. Typo. Okay, so that's string 10A. So that's the constructors. You can access the characters in the string using just the bracket symbol. So I'm just going to use in, but that's not really going to work. But I'll show you why. So length i++. Cout s1, so to access, I need to initialize it to 0. So to access like the ith character, you need this. And this sort of works. This, right, hello world, sort of works, except that there's a warning. It's comparison between, let me try, it's a sine and sine integer expression. Okay, so the reason is that length, if you look at length, go to the documentation at C++.com, if you look at length, it's returning size t. The size t happens a whole bunch of times, like it's like everywhere. Size t is an unsigned integer, so that's why, you know, int is a signed integer. So to get rid of the warning, you have to use size t. This will get rid of the warning. See, there are no more warnings. So that's how you work with strings and also a lot of stuff. You have to use size t, else it's going to have warnings. And this is how you access the character, the bracket, the array notation here. Next, about concatenating strings. String s2, I guess I'll say good morning. So like string s3, s2, plus s1. So this is going to be good morning, hello world, if I do it correctly. So that's how you concatenate a string. You can also, there's also that plus equal thing that, you know, that's how you append to it. So, pen ending to string, I guess. So here we have the appending to string here. So that's the plus equal and the equal, the plus sign and the plus equal sign. Anything? You can get a old style pointer from the string object. So if you have this, this is actually const. That's one that there's a function called cstring. See, it cstring returns a constant character pointer. So for some functions that require constant character pointer, you can use this to get to extract it. Now this is just a pointer. It's not a new string. So if I change the old string to, you know, the string has been changed, right? This pointer here is gonna be pointing to, you know, the string has been changed, and that's gonna be the output. Oh wait, it's not. Sorry. Well, that's not expected. So I was expecting the string has been changed. Okay, but it's outputting the original string. So actually, if you copy this and you go Windows, the Windows Visual Studio, and you do the same thing here, it's different behavior, right? It's this thing. Okay, so this kind of thing, is not reliable. So what you have to do is this. You have to get this again, because the original pointer, the S pointer at this point is no longer valid. So you have to do that again. So do that again. So now on Windows, you would do this. You have the string has been changed. So apply the same kind of thing here, I guess. The string has been changed, right? So I guess when you get a pointer from it, that it this is a pointer. This doesn't allocate a new copy or anything, or it's not supposed to. So, and you don't have to worry about deleting it or anything. And you need to make a new allocation like this. So you need to use it like right away, because once you have something like this, then at this point, if you print it out, it becomes unpredictable, you know, at this point, what this is. Okay, so the next thing is the find function. Find. This one, the find. Now, find function is returning a size t, okay? So, we just look for the e. So the size t. If they can't find a character, let's use x. There's no x in the string, right? If they can't find a character, it's gonna be string dot this one, and you know that because of documentation. Find, you know, you can supply a string, or you can supply characters, C style character, or what I'm doing is I'm using this version, finding character. The return value is a size t. If no matches were found, the function returns n position. So CL, you know, not found. LCLI goes like this. Not found. Okay. Let me me do something more here. Let me print out the value of I here. CLI, just to make a point. I is this 4 billion whatever number. This is actually the maximum number. So if you cast it to integer, this is actually minus 1. But again, you know, because of type tracking, you have to use size t, and you have to use you should be using size t, and you should be using string and position here, right? But let's just print it out. This is minus 1, so it actually works if you just do it like any other find function. You just compare the I to minus 1. This will work, but you're supposed to be using size t there. If you have a number, so if you have a character that actually exists, like E, right, this is character 1, right, this should return a 1. And use the version, they have a version that looks for a string, right, so, they can do that too. Right, I'm saying that they let you pick the starting location here. Okay, so... So I'm looking for the L. So if I start at, you know, 0, 1, 2, 3, right, 3 is here. So if I start at 4, 3, it's gonna find this L right away, right? If I start at 4, you know, just over here, they're gonna find the L at the very end. The other thing is you can use a string, right, LLO. So they found LLO inside of that. So that's a find function. There's also an erase function. Oh boy, a bunch of stuff. Well, just read documentation, it's easier than reading IntelliSense in a lot of cases. Erase. So erase takes an iterator, or they take a position, so I'll just use a position. Or they can take an iterator. I'll go over iterators later on some other topic like the linked list, because that's where you're forced to use an iterator, because you can't utilize absolute positions. But here I can use a position, so I'm going to use a position. So 3, and the other one's like 2, right? That's the number of characters erase, I think. So 0, 1, 2, 3. So I'm going to erase L, that's 3, and I'm erasing 2 characters, so LO should be gone, right? So this should be hell world. The L has been erased. So that's a find, that's the erase function. One thing the string class is missing, if you look at this, there's no trim. There's no trim function here, so there's no way to trim white spaces at the beginning or at the end of the string. There's a way to do it, but you can't do it using this thing. There are actually more functions possible in the algorithm class, because this thing, has a lot of functions, and you can plug string into these functions as well. These functions accept general data structures, not just a string. But of the functions utilized in string, I think those are the most useful ones. The ones I just covered, find and erase. If you look at string documentation, this is string documentation. This is actually a basic string, okay? String is the class, okay? Basic string is the template. So string is actually a specialization of the basic string template. String is using 8-bit characters. There's a U16 string. This one is, this is a basic string. See, it's basic string, but it's using 16-bit characters. So if you click on string is a basic string. The string class is a basic string. That's utilizing a standard character. So that's the story on base. That's what the story on basic string. So all these things actually work on basic string. They actually come from basic string. And the next thing covers a string stream. Type in here. String stream. So S stream. String stream is a converting class. It lets you convert between strings and numbers. So I'm gonna get to 123.45, right? So if I want to convert this to a floating point, x, to use string stream, you have to pound include, you know, the string stream, the SS stream here, string stream, include S stream. So you have to declare it. And so the way you use it is you throw the S1 string into it, and you can just get out your X like that. Okay, so that's gonna give you the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. X has been converted from string to floating point. Now, if you want to use this object again, you have to do this. You have to do clear. So you have to call clear. If you want to use it again for something else, try something else. Say convert from integer to string, right? So int pi 3.14159. So I'm gonna throw it into that. I'm gonna get out S1. So S1. This is gonna be the 3.4. Oh, just 3. Oh. Because it's an int. See, it's an int, so it became a 3. If you use float, it'd be 3.4. Now, if you don't have the clear, it's not gonna work. It's gonna give out whatever that was there before, so it'd be the 1, 2, 3, 4. I mean the 1, 2, 3.45. Right, because I didn't call clear. So it's very important to call clear every time you use it, call clear, except for the first time you don't have to call clear. Okay, so that wraps it up for strings. The vector is the dynamic array class in the STL. This is very useful. So to use the vector, you have to pound include vector and construct a vector. The vector is of course a template, so if you want a vector of number integers, this is what you type in. You can give it an initializer list, but currently this doesn't work in Visual Studio. In the Express edition that I have anyways, it doesn't work. But it's really handy, so I'll use this in the video, but in general I don't use this because it doesn't work in Windows. I try to stick to things that'll work in both Linux and Windows. So anyways, if you want to print it out, you can do the for loop. Well, the size t thing again. SMV dot size. Yeah, you access the vector using that array of notation like this. Oops, not this. So this is how. So using this to access the vector and using size to tell how many elements are there in the vector. Okay. To add more elements to vector, you use a pushback. So we add a number. So this will add 10 to the end of the vector. To remove an element from the back of the vector. Okay, you have a pop back. this is only, you know, this removes the last element vector. Now's a good time to illustrate one thing. A vector is a dynamic array, so there's a capacity and a size. The size is the number of elements that's in the vector. Capacity is the total memory that's allocated for the number of slots allocated for this. So I can illustrate that by writing the capacity at this point. Right, capacity. And capacity at this point. And they're going to be the same. Okay. So the capacity is 8, but there's actually fewer than 8 items. It's like 4 items plus 1. So it's like 5 items. At this point, there are 5 items. And then when I remove this thing, it's at this point, after pop back, there's only 4 items left, but capacity still says 8. Okay. So capacity is the total number of slots. So I have a picture here, right? So it's what's in there? 1, 2, 3, 4. So they allocated 8 slots. You know, it's only 7 here, but the idea is, you know, so there's some empty slots in this vector class. So next, there's an insert function. Insert. Now, go to the documentation for the insert. In general, the IntelliSense is like, it's like messed up. It's like this. I mean, it's much easier to look at what a function does via the insert. So here's a vector. Just go vector, whatever. So insert here. So it's listed here too, I guess. Modifiers. This is insert. So to use the insert class, here are the versions of different variants of the insert function, but they all require an iterator. So now's a good time to go over iterators. So this is the first time iterators are used in this video. So an iterator is kind of like a pointer. So you get one by vbegin. This gives you an iterator that points to the beginning of the vector. So before I do the insert thing, you just go over iterators. Just comment this out. And go take a detail about iterators. Iterators in general have a very complex type. Say iterator I, right? So begin. So I'm not gonna, you know, define the type because it returns, what does it return, right? Oh, it returns the iterators, whatever. So that's why the auto keyword is used, so I don't have to worry about the type. So I, you know, v begin, so this is, I is pointing to 1. So iterator is kind of like a pointer if you want to, you know, print out the content. Use the star I. So it gets 1. It's kind of like a point, also like a pointer. You can kind of increment it. So CLI star I. This is going to print out 2. Okay. So begin is one iterator. The other iterators are end. Now this actually points to the element beyond the 4. It doesn't point to 4. So if you print it out, I don't know what it will give it. I don't know what it's going to give you, but you can always try. Okay, so it's giving you 0. It's pointing to behind the 4, it's 4, whatever. But this first one is not that reliable. You know, this is to prove that the iterator v.end is pointing to the element beyond the 0, beyond the 4. You do the I minus minus and then you get 4. So that's the end. in my version of the environment, in my version of the library, there's only begin end. There's no C begin and C end. Actually, C begin and C end are actually part of the standard if you go over here. Oh, whatever. If you go to the Microsoft version of it, there's actually C begin, right? So here's a C begin. Okay. C begin also points to beginning, but C begin returns a constant iterator that's read only. So for this situation, be I plus plus. Oh, in this case, this doesn't work. Okay. So like I said, in Windows, this initialize list thing doesn't work. So you're gonna have to push back. The pushback function adds to the vector, so you know, do something like that. Okay. So I'm using C begin, and it's gonna do the same thing. It's gonna print out one in the first element, and it's gonna print out two. Right. So it's 1 and 2 here. Oops. Wait. But the difference is that with C begin, you can't modify it. So let me go back to here. See, with this one, you can actually modify it. So I print out I, right? So this is 4. Okay, so I can 10, you know. Actually, and just confirm it. Right. So both of these lines should be printing out the final element. Let's make it begin again, just be consistent. Let's make this plus plus. So it's not 4 anymore, it's just like 2. It's 1. Okay. Okay. So in this version, I went back to begin again. So because I'm using begin, I'm getting an iterator that's, you know, writable. So what that means is I can do this. I star I equals 10, you know, and then this element here became 10. I can use it like this. But if you go back to Windows, here I'm using C begin. So if you try to do something like 10 or something like that, it's not going to or sorry, flag and error, like expression must be a modifiable type. You can try to build it. Give some error. You cannot assign to, you know, a variable that's const. Expression must be a modifiable type. So that's the difference between C begin and begin. And C begin returns something that's read only. It's not writable. And the same thing, there's also a C end. You know, there's just to show that there is a C end here. But it's not there in this environment, in the Linux version. So if you don't need to modify the data, it's better to use C begin. But since they don't have it, I'm not going to use C begin till both sides have C begin. Okay. So that's going over iterator. So back to the original topic, which is to insert something into the array, you need an iterator. So I'm using begin. Oh, here. And see begin 4. Okay. And 4, 10. Okay. So this should put a 10. It puts a 10 at the beginning of the vector. So if I insert, like, say, here, right, if I put something here, so C begin plus 2, okay? So this will insert something here in the middle. This insert, this also, oh, before I go on, insert is relatively inefficient. So if you have some, so you start out like this, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, to insert something in the beginning, internally they have to, you know, copy all this. They have to move the 1, 2, 3, 4 one cell back, and then they put a 10 here, for example. So if you have a lot of elements, inserting in the beginning is very inefficient. So suppose that I have to insert like 3 different numbers. I don't want to call insert 3 times because, you know, it's inefficient. So they have a form of insert that lets you enter in the size. Okay. So suppose you're inserting 3 numbers at the very beginning. We don't want to call begin, so we'll call 3, 10. So this will put, you know, 3 tens in the beginning, and then you can like insert. You're not insert. There's only one insert call. Yeah, that's the point. It goes 11, and the next element equals 12. 12, right? So instead of calling insert 10 and then insert 11 and insert 12, the idea is you call insert one time, you're using this telling to insert 3 numbers, right? So when they do that copying thing, you know, they make one copy, right? It's just, you know, it used to be 1, 2, 3, 4, just make one copy, and then they have 3 empty slots out here that you can use to do the insertion through the array notation. So that's the point of using insert, like multiple numbers, make it more efficient. And there's insert, well, there's also erase then. So erase, say there's 11, 13, 15. Yeah, erase also takes an iterator. Just to be sure. Erase. See, there's only two versions of erase. They both take iterator. So no, you can't just enter in like an index number and have it erase. You have to get the iterator. So begin. So erase 11, right? So begin will point to 1. Begin plus 1. Begin plus 2. So this is begin plus 3. So this should erase the 11. Right. This output, the 11's gone. The other form of begin lets you erase multiple numbers. So v dot begin or end. Right. So my erase starts at 11. Now I want to erase 11 through 15. V.n is pointing to the element beyond 4, right? So n minus 1 points to this one. Okay, n minus 2 points to this one, but so look at the documentation about this. This is another one of those conventions that that's pretty popular in this library. So notice this thing, okay? The first element is included, the last element is excluded. So where does it say that? Here does it say that. The range includes the element between the first and last, including the element pointed to the first, by the first, but not the one pointed by last. So the element pointed by last, okay, in this call, in this erase call, this last, this element doesn't get erased. So this is a convention similar to Python, for example. When you have a range, the last element is not included in the actual list. So this work. OK. Okay, so like I said, and n points to the last one, n minus 1 points to this one. So you use n minus 1 here. So yeah, n minus 1 is pointing to this one, but it's not included in the arrays. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, the 11, 13, 15 got erased. So that's erased, and oh, vector, yeah, vector is one more thing. This is a vector bool thing. If you look at the documentation here, down here there's a vector and there's a vector bool. So vector bool, it's a specialized version of vector, swap member and a new signature member of swaps. So the main thing is bool, it's got this flip thing. Okay, it's got a flip function. It flips all the Boolean values from true to false and vice versa. So just to demonstrate that. So 0, 1, 1, 0, I guess. So it's a v.flip. So look at this one. So see the output is 1001. So all the 0 got flipped to 1, or the 1 got flipped to 0. So that's vector bool. It's just, it has this flip thing in it. So record that I mentioned that inserting an element is not efficient. So vector deck. There's a class called deck. It's similar to a vector, but it lets you efficiently insert into the front of the element. So the deck has a push front and push back. So to use a deck, you have to deck here. And deck. Decks represents a double-ended queue. So D, E for double-ended and Q, U, E for queue. So let me demonstrate 1, 2, 3, 4. Right. Deck has the push. See, vector can only have push back, but deck has a push front. So 10. Push 1, 11. So this is going to be 11, 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Doesn't build. Int. So 11, 10, 1, 2, 3, 4. So for deck, it sort of pushes things into the beginning. So internally, a deck is just a vector is that one single dynamic array. A deck is like two dynamic arrays. One dynamic array lets you add to the back, and the other dynamic array lets you add to the front. So that's deck. So a list is the list object is a linked list. To use this, pound include list, and to create a list of integers. Okay, so the list, you know, it's a lot like the deck in that it has a push front and it also has a push back, because in a linked list you can easily get to the front or the back element. So just use that to add some numbers, right? One. And I use push back to add a couple more numbers in the back, 20. Now it's a linked list, so you don't have this array thing anymore. Like, yeah, that doesn't work anymore. Let's see what happens. Whatever. So you have to use iterators. To get an iterator, you use like L dot begin or you know L dot end. That's also possible. Of course, you also have C begin and C end, but just not in this version of Linux that I'm using. So just use I'll use the iterator to traverse it. And so you know, iterator is kind of like a pointer to advanced iterator, you know, plus plus, or you know, to have it go another way, you use minus minus, to print out the content. Do it like just like a pointer, and that should be it. Because when it hits end, end actually points to the element after the last element, so you don't want to print out end. Yeah, so when it hits end, it's not gonna run this. So this should be correct. So so push back has this you know, it's in the right order. Push front, of course, it's kind of like a stack. If you're pushing in front, the first item goes in, you know, deepest into the list. So let me just traverse it the other way. So that's, yeah, front to back. So can also traverse it like this now. Let's see. Right, because in the very beginning, N will point it at the element after 22. So Cout IT would actually not bring out anything. So IT minus minus actually takes it to like 22. Or I shouldn't say that. But okay. So the end condition should have something to do with the beginning, I guess. Get this equal begin. So the first element print out will be 22, but by the time it gets to 3, you know, it's going to have ID minus minus here. ID begin. So this should be okay, because it's going to print out 3. And then it's going to see, you know, it's going to fail this because, you know, 3 is the begin. 3 is the very first element, so it should be okay. So it prints it out in the opposite direction, you know, from back to front. This is, of course, possible because it's a doubly linked list. So there's also erase and insert for this one. But because this thing's limited to iterators only, so I'll do an example of erase and insert. Erase, so you have two of them. So this one actually erase a range, and this one erase one position. So I'll just go over here, just get some more documentation. C++11. Oh, they didn't really divide it, huh? Well, but anyways, just erase one position and erase the whole range. So let me erase the 21. Right, let me erase 21. Okay. And now this will point to the 22. Okay. Now at this point, it points to 21. Right. So. So this should erase the 21. So it should be 22, no 21. So just run it. So there goes 21. Another the other method that's pretty useful is insert. So go over here out that. So this one. So this one insert to a position. This one insert to this, so it's actually longer than this. So okay, scroll over. Okay, so this one inserts the whole range from another list, actually. So it's this one inserts a number, this one inserts a bunch of numbers. It's a little bit more clear over here if you look at the C++ documentation. Yeah, the IntelliSense for C++ in general is not that good, so this kind of thing is pretty useful. So see, now this time they had this, you know, they had this stuff here, you know, oh, this is a single element, this is a fill, this is a range. You know, this is a move, this is whatever. So single element is just this. Let me use the fill. So I can insert n elements and they're, you know, of the same value. So which one is this one actually, right? Whatever. IT. Say I want to insert 10 elements of 99 each. So I can run this. And yeah, you know, this just got, I see it got terminated. Okay, so something went wrong, but this, I'll take the shortcut on figure out what went wrong. You can go over to Windows and run in Windows. It's a lot more, you know, because they have a better debugger, in my opinion. But actually, you don't need it. So to tell you that the list insert iterator is outside of range, so that should give you a clue. Actually, it fails right here. It's just why I just added. So it's okay up here, and next one it goes over here. Okay, abort list insert outside range. Yeah, this is because the erase actually destroys the iterator. I don't know if you can see it or not. Oh, whatever. Nope, I guess not. Stop. But the idea is that the erase destroyed the iterator, so you can't keep using that iterator anymore. You have to get the iterator over again. So let me get this. So you have to get this over again. You do this over again, and yeah. Goes toward the beginning. Let's see how this should work. So inserts a bunch of 99s, 10 of them, you know, right before 22, but we're printing out backwards. So okay, so that's, oh, there's also a similar to list, there's a forward list, but the forward list actually doesn't work in the Linux version, so I'll just go over Windows again. Yeah, don't worry, the forward list is part of the standard. It's, you know, forward list. This is in the standard, so it's not something that Microsoft Store made up. It's just that it's been implemented over in Visual Studio, but it hasn't been implemented in the other one. Well, actually, the other one's not the most recent version anyways. So forward list. Forward list. So forward list is a singly linked list. So it goes only in one direction. That's why, you know, there's only push front. There's no push back. Okay, and it's likewise, there's only pop front. There's no pop back because it's a singly linked list. But otherwise, it's the same as the other one. Okay, that's it for lists. Okay, to use the set, you need to include set. Then you can just declare it like my set. So this is a most basic case. In general, you're going to be using a custom data structure instead of an integer. So For this example, I'll just make up something simple. Person, person with like an ID and a name. Constructor. So so over here you can do this. You can use your custom class in your in the set. Now a set is a binary tree, so that means items are sorted when you insert them into the set. So items are kept in a sorted order. So to support sorting, you have to support the less than operator. Actually, const. And this is not just for set, it's actually for pretty much any of the data structures in the STL. You need to have the less than operator to support sorting, and you have to have the equality operator to support find. So you have to have this operator support to find. The same thing basically. Oops. For sorting, I'm gonna sort based on the ID. The other way would be to sort on the name, but so this ID is less than person.id. And for equality, I'll compare it using the ID. Have constructor. Like I said, this is for any pretty much any data structure. But because in this case, this is a binary tree. The set is a binary tree, so the less than operator is actually required, because without things being in a sorted order, this data structure doesn't work. So this less than operator is kind of optional for some other data structures, but in this case it is required. So to add to this my set, you use insert. A couple options, but you know, just construct it. ID 1, person A, I guess. Person B, person C. Okay, to display it, it's just like the other stuff. You get an iterator and you go from beginning to ending. So it my set dot begin. Oops. And let me give a print function here. for the display. So while this iterator is not the end, we'll just keep printing, keep incrementing it. Print. Some errors. So, yeah, because I made it a string, I can't just do that. Has to be like this. Still doesn't work because use this in the so string is different from string reference. Let's do this. Oops. So another message here is const person qualifier, so maybe this. So this is necessary. Even though this is a begin C begin. In general, because this data structure is a binary tree, so in general you shouldn't modify the data structure via the iterator, because if you modify it, then that person class might not be in sorted order anymore, so then it might not work anymore. So in general you can't modify it you can't modify the content after you insert it in. Yeah, because that throws it out of the sorted order. Anyways, so now it builds pile, so 1, 2, 3. So it's how to traverse. There's a find function, find. So make a person, const person. Now it's checking the ID only, so let's say 2, right? Oh. So name doesn't really matter. Checking ID and if it's found, if it's not found, you know, the iterator, if they can't find it, it's going to be the end iterator. Not found. If it's found, dot print. Print. Oh. See how found. No problems. So found. Didn't really look at the X. If I make this 4, it will be not found. Okay, so not found, that's find function. You can also erase. So axis. So I'm looking for 2 here. If I look for 2 here, it's going to be fine. Found, so let me try to erase the 2 over here. So it'll be not found, and it's no longer listed. Oh, it's only one of 3 because I erased it here. So let's erase. So that's basically the set. There's also a multi-set. With the set, if you put another person, let me take out the erase. If you put another person with the same ID, that this the second one, C second, the C second is going to get ignored. So here, right? So they only list the first one, C. Okay, the multi-set lets you have multiple entries. So set only lets you have one entry, one unique entry. So if you the determining uniqueness using the equal comparison operator here. So if you use put in second person, that's the same ID, it won't work. But multi-set lets you do that. So it's multi-set. I think that's it. Yeah, it's like the same thing except for multi-set will let you do like 2. Right, but then that brings up a question: what happens when you look for it, right? So look for it here, right? So I'm gonna look for 3. So it's gonna find the first one. That's what's gonna happen. So how do you get both of them? Okay. So here, instances found. Well, to know how, there's actually 2 of them because I inserted 2 of them. So to get that, my set dot count. Okay. Oops. Whatever. So this is gonna tell you, this is how you know how many instances there are. There's a count function, and the IT actually points to both of them. So instances, I think this is better. Yeah, so first I use count to find out how many instances are found, and then for each instance found, I'm gonna call the ITD print. I'll call the print function. So this will find both of them. So here's the first one found, and here's the second one found because of this thing. So let me do one more thing. Let me toss them out of order. Just show they, because this is a binary tree, so things actually sorted as you insert them. Right, they're sorted according to the ID, according to this operator, which sorts according to the ID. So put them, kind of mix them out of order a little bit. Still find them, and so I'm inserting them kind of out of order, but they're still in order when you display them. They're 1, 2, 3. You can specify the short order. That you might want to do that sometimes if you want them to sort in a particular order, or you can change this. But the other way to do it is you can change this, of course. to have it stored in different order. The other way is you can provide a custom short object. So struct, you can use class or structure, it doesn't matter. To have a custom short object, it's basically the parenthesis operator. That's the operator you want to be changing. That's the operator. I don't need public. Yeah, struct defaults to public. Left. Right, const. Left. So the default is it's like this, right? The default is the less than operator. So if I want to print this in the reverse order, I'll change the default to this one. Turn false. So let's try that. Oh, once you have this short object. So this is what they call a function object. It's basically a class that has this operator overloaded. Basically, they execute the object via this operator. So short to right, I don't have a greater than. I actually only have this. Okay, so the default is to if less than, return true. So I'm gonna return false, I guess. that won't work. That's no, but then equality is not like that. Okay. Cause this is the right way to do it. If yeah, so let me try this. So builds. Yeah, so by providing my own short too, I'm having my own custom short order, a different short order than the default short order. So if I take out this again, it goes back to the default short order, 1, 2, 3. So that's how you do the custom short order. There's also an order set, but so set and also multi-set, they are binary trees. There's a variant, the unorder set, that's the hash table. Okay, so, but actually it doesn't work here. But I'm not gonna try here because it won't work. It doesn't work in Linux. It does work in Windows. So let me just. Switch to this. Just show that an order set. Base this an order set now. This still won't work. The reason being that there's no hash function. This is a hash table, so it needs a hash function. There's no hash function for this in the library. So if I try to build it, so 7. Right, it doesn't provide hash. Right, there's no hash function. But this will work. Okay. So if you use an int, it will work because there's a hash function for an int. See, so this work. Over there in Linux, this won't work. It's not supported yet, I guess. But this unordered set, this is in the standard, so. But in general, you have to provide hash function, so that's a problem. Most of the time when you're using sets, it's going to be a custom class anyway, so I don't want to do hash function. So effectively, no order set is not that useful. This variation of the set is not that useful. An order map, which I'll go over, talk about a little bit, it's more useful because for an order map, there will be a hash function because, you know, the key is going to be int or string in that case. So I guess I'm done with the set. So go over to map. Map is just like the set, except map has like a lookup table. I mean, map has two entries. So set, there's only one here. But map, you're going to have two entries. So we'll get rid of this and go to something simpler. This is just to show the how to use a... Actually, I want to keep it short too. I'll be using it later on. Yeah, this is just to show how to use a custom class with the data structure. But for map, I'll go back to the simple case. Yeah, so map, it's like a lookup table. So the first entry is the key. This one's the value. In general, the key, in my experience, is always an int or a string. So you're looking stuff up via int, like an ID, or you're looking stuff up via a string, which is you're looking stuff up via some kind of name. Here it is, start over again, basically. Map. Map has the insert function, just like set has the insert function. So, but you're inserting a pair, so you can use a make pair. One. This is a classical example, a string to a integer kind of lookup table, integer to string lookup table. The other way to do this, you can also do it like this. Okay, and yeah, another way to do this, map has this special notation. Oh, I shouldn't be doing the same thing. Yeah, because it doesn't let you insert the same thing. So you can do this. So those are the different ways to insert things into map. So to traverse it, it's just like before, you get iterator. Oh, shouldn't call map, should call my map or something, right? So get the iterator via begin. While the iterator is not the end. Increment the iterator. Just keep incrementing iterator until iterator hits the end. In the meantime, print out the iterator. So this is where there's a difference here. So to get the first element, you print out first. That's the key first. So this first is the int in this case. The first is the int first. And the second element's value. So the value in this library is called second. Yeah, because I'll be doing the same shorting thing, so... I'll be doing the same custom short example here later on, so... Run it, 1, 2, 3, so that's how you traverse it. So I'll do the find and erase, but it's basically the same thing. Because you're looking, the argument going to find is the key. The key to the lookup table, which is the first, the integer. So blah, 2 here. Same thing as before, if it's not found, it's gonna be the end. Oops. It's not IT found. Right, so if you put a 2, it's gonna find it. If you put a 4, it's not gonna find it. Not found. Put a 2, it's gonna find it again. Demonstrate erase. Alright, so if I erase it here, I erase. Oops. Oh wait. If I erase 2. It's gonna be not found because I erased it here. So let's find an erase for this one. This prints out the first and second. This guess there's a different way to do this. Like instead of second, let me get rid of this first. I get rid of erase, so it's gonna find it. Found 2. So instead of this, I could have throw I don't know. You see. You know, if it's found, right? So could 2. Okay. So this gives you the string 2 TWO. Yeah, if you know you found it, right? It's not gonna work if there are no 2, so that's the alternative way to print out the value, the alternative syntax. Okay, this is how you set it, you know. Right, you can also use you know the syntax here for printing it. Okay, so that's the basic map. There's also multi-map. It's just like before that you if you insert another one, so 3, you know, 3 seconds, and this thing can only have one entry, so let's see what it is. So 3 seconds, so only the first one, right? And if you try to do this, it's just gonna modify it, I think 3/3 or something. This is just gonna modify it 3/3. Okay, but you can't do a second, a 3 second here. They only have one entry because it's map. Now you can make it multi-map. Okay, multi-map, just like the multi-set. Multi means that you can have multiple entries that are the same. So you can have three, and you can have 3 second. But this thing won't let you have the operator. When you use a multi-map, you see, when you use a multi-map, you can't use this notation anymore. Okay. And also over here, can't do this anymore. So instead of this, I have to do this. Right, because this operator, the bracket thing, is not the indexer. I guess that's the name of Google. The indexing operator is not allowed anymore. Do this. So now, because of the multi-map, I have two of them. And it's just like before, you know, find's gonna find the first one. Right, it's gonna find three cycles, find 3 seconds. So once it's found, you have to see how many instances there are. Instances found, just like the last example, basically. My map dot count 3. And you iterate over both of them. Let's get the first one found plus plus. Right, so you get instance found, and you print out both of them. So see if this works. So first, second instance found. Oh, and you have the same custom short. Yeah, the map. And also the multi-map is using a binary tree underneath. So this is default short order. You don't create any operator for it because by default, the integer shorts like this, like 1, 2, 3, ascending order. So this is a reverse, right? So the default short order is like this. Right, So my reverse short is going to be using greater than sign. Now, before I couldn't do that because of for the class, I didn't overload the greater than sign, but in this one I could. So just create. So when you declare the map, you the first entry here is the key. This is the value, and the third entry is the short function object. So just reverse. So this reverses the short order because I'm using this specialized shorting object. That's a custom short. Now there's also an unordered variant, but also it doesn't work on the Linux. So I move over to Windows. Unordered map. So it's gonna change this. Now the map or the multi-map is using a sorting function because that's a binary tree. So for the unordered map, this would be a hash function. And of course, sort 2 is not a hash function. This is just, so just forget about it. I don't wanna get into sorting function, hashing function, because usually, like I said, the key, the first entry, this key is either an integer or a string, and the library already has a hash function for that kind of thing. So usually this will work, right? Because the unordered set didn't work because I have to create a hash function for the object. But in this case, like there's already a hash function here, so this should work. I have to try it though. So it builds. No errors. So run that down here. So there we go. So 1, 2, 3. It's exactly the same thing. This is the only line I changed. Hash table. Now since it's a hash table, you have some underlying like statistics that you can look at. Although I actually never do look at those. But if you want to, you can have my map dot. It's a bunch of them. So account. This account. What else is there? It's the size. Hash table x hash size hash table. Oh, there's some stuff like hash table stuff like a load factor. There's a bucket thing. So bucket count, bucket size. Maximum bucket count. So, load factor. Yeah, there's a load factor and also a maximum load factor. So those are some of the hash table parameters, you know, if you ever need them. So that's it. Oh, summary, yeah. Summary. So the associative containers, the set and map, there's actually 8 of them. Okay, so how do you get 8 of them? Well, there's, you know, 3 factors, and each factor has 2 choices. So first of all, it's the element, a single element or a pair, right? A set takes in a single element, a map, you know, takes in like a key value pair. So maps like this, has this thing here, the pair thing. Okay. So factor number 2, are we using a binary tree or a hash table? So the default is a binary tree, so that'll be a set, multi-set, or a map, or multi-map. Those are binary trees. And there's an unordered variant here that you can use. Yeah, like this one, unordered map, that's the hash table version. So number 3, do we allow unique elements, or... I mean, what happens when you insert duplicates, right? The default is that they only take in unique elements. So if you insert a duplicate, the duplicate gets ignored. So the default be set. So the multivariant lets you insert non-unique duplicate entries. So be like multi-set, multi-map. Then you have your unordered multi-set, unordered multi-map. So here, could have like an ordered, like that, like an ordered multi-map, you know. So this one's a good. See, there's a 1, 2, 3, and 3 second. But if you run this one, right, there's only 3. There's no 3 second here. So this changes to an ordered multi-map. And this time you should have a 3 second. Right. So that's the third factor, yeah. Unique elements or no unique elements. So each factor you have 2 choices, and that's how you get a total of 8 different data structures in this associative containers group. Now I'll go over adaptive containers. Adaptive containers are data structures that are actually wrappers around some of the other data structures I went over previously. So for example, the stack, underlying the stack, inside the stack data structure is actually either a vector, a deck, or a linked list. So it's called an adaptive container because when you create a stack, you can decide what data structure to use underneath the stack, what to base the stack upon. Another thing is that the priority queue is not really a queue, and I searched this online, like to my dismay, a lot of people, a lot of like notes, postings actually treat the priority queue data structure as a priority queue. It's not really a queue because it's a priority something. It resorts objects to the priority. But it's not a queue because for something to be a queue, the object that went in first needs to come out first. So to use a stack, you have to pancake the stack. And you can declare a stack like this, basically. But because ultimately I need to go over the priority queue and you show that why it's not really a queue, I think I'll just create the custom data structure right now. Let's just create the task object right now because I'll need this ultimately. So for now, I'll just give the task a name, that's it. And constructor, oops. No more priority, no, not yet. Oh. This needs to come earlier. And print function. So this would be this. So if you look at this, if you go to the documentation, if you look at the stack, it's called an adaptive container because, you know, look at this. The standard container classes, vector, deck, and list fulfill these requirements. So when I create a stack like this, just stack and just a template for the data structure. When I do that, by default, the standard container deck is used. Now I don't know how they decide on this. I mean, it seems like to me that the linked list is the better data structure because in a stack you're just accessing the very last element. You don't need to access elements in the middle. So I don't know why they don't default to a linked list, but so that's what it is. For now, I'll just use this. You add stuff to it by using the push. So also, there's not that many of them actually. So you can easily go over all this. Task one, I guess. So next, I guess, is to display it while s dot. So I'm going to pop it all, and then as I pop them, I'll display them. So it's empty while empty is false. I'll be popping them. And as I pop them, I'll call the print top. Okay, so s dot top is how you access the elements on the stack. See pop. Pop returns a void and doesn't take any arguments. So pop just remove an element from the stack. Pop doesn't give you access to the element itself. So there you go. So because it's a stack, the thing that went in first shows up last. The thing that went in last, you know, task three went in last, it showed up first. Other thing is, that's a size thing. Just want to show you. So I already used all these functions. I haven't used this one yet. So that's it. So size should be 3, of course. So there's a size 3, just to show the size. So that's it for stack. Oh yeah, I mentioned that this is gonna use a deck, right? According to the documentation, the standard container deck is used if you don't specify a container. So if to make it use the list, do this list task, but then the list You have to pan include the list. Get a linked list. So build nothing. Oops. So same thing, exactly the same thing. All I change is this one line where when I create a stack, I'm using list as the underlying data structure. So next up is the queue. So be the queue here. Just change this to queue. Queue has the same push and the same pop and the same empty thing. Now the queue doesn't have a top. Okay, so this is gone. You don't have a top. They have a front and they have a back. So here's the back. Oh, here's the back. Here's the front. Front of the queue. Run it. Nope. Didn't go well. Right, so it should be print. So that do it. Okay, so now I run it, fix that. So for a queue, the thing that went in first, task one went in first. The thing that went in first comes out first. So that's a queue. So and the final remaining data structure is a priority queue. So I'll go over here a little bit. Priority queue cannot use the list, but just to show what can it use, right? So priority queue. Graph, standard vector, a vector deck, a vector is fine. Basically, it's like a sorted list. Q. So this should be priority queue, and don't use the list because you can't. You know, it's not good for sorting. Okay, to sort, you need the task needs a priority. And the sorting is done by the less than operator, the less than operator. Operator less than this thing. Const task. So I'm gonna sort based on the priority, I guess. So priority less than task dot. False. And the constructor also needs to set the priority. So this also needs a priority then. Oh, and a priority queue doesn't have front, even though it's called a queue. It's, you know, it has the top thing. So priority queue is more like a stack in this sense, in the API sense. Oh, and if you build this won't work. Cause let me just build and show you the error message. So const task const, so it has to be const, passing const task. The priority queue is a shorted data structure so that the member functions can't change what's inside of the object, because if you change what's inside object, it might not be in shorted order anymore. So that's why this has to be const, because so it's not allowed to change, you know, priority, basically. It's similar to the set and the map. They have a similar constraint that, you know, if people are allowed to change what's inside the object, then the data structure, you know, it won't be in order anymore. And then this data structure, the map, the set, or in this case, the priority queue, the data structure will be out of order. So this fix that. So it's gone now, and after I did the const thing, this thing is so gone now. So 3 shows up, you know, I'm pushing 1, 2, 3, but 3 shows up, 3 has the highest priority. Add a couple more. B, C, and let me kind of shuffle the order a little bit here. So 3 is still, you know, top priority, 3 highest priority number shows up first, and it shows up in order to like 3A, 3B, 3C. So far it seems to work, but actually it doesn't work, okay? It just seems to work for now. So, you know, let's just change this. Right, show you. Okay, now 4 has the highest priority. So 4 goes to the front of the queue, which is correct. But, you know, 3A, B, and C are now out of order, which is incorrect. So the priority queue does bump things up and down the queue according to priority. You know, the 3 actually comes up ahead of 1, even though 3 comes in after 1. So that's right, but the order is not preserved, because in order for it to be a priority queue, you know, 3A needs to, you know, these 3 tasks, they have the same priority, okay? So 3A needs to be first, and then followed by 3B and 3C. So this is not, you know, ABC, and it's not, you know, CBA either, so it's something, so this is why I say the priority queue doesn't work. Even though you might see a lot of, you know, postings and examples pretending that this thing actually works, it doesn't, right? It's just something like this. I mean, to make it work, you have to do more work, basically. When you're sorting, you can't just sort based on priority. You have to sort based on some kind of auto ID number. So just to make it work, you have to have some kind of count, right? Then I had a task count. Right, so the plan is that every time I construct an object, I do a count plus plus and kind of keep track of, you know, like an ID number basically. So every time I construct an object, I take the count and I increment the count. Okay, so the task count is a number I track how old the object is basically. Okay. Oh, and I also need to initialize this. And this doesn't show up, but it's there. Oops. So when program runs, the count is going to be 0. First time I create it, task count, the first task will have a task count of 0. Increment count. The next time I create a task, the second task will have a task count value of 1 and so on. So this is a new change. Oh yeah. So when I sort things, you know, when the sorting occurs in this function, I can't just do this. For equal priority. For the equal priority case, I would have to sort based on the task count. Okay. So is it less than or greater than, right? That's the other question. Okay, so in this case, I mean, to follow the same logic here, if it's a lower priority, I return true. Okay, so lower priority, you know, the corresponding logic is if the lower priority means that it's comes in later in the queue. So the corresponding logic is that if the count is smaller, so that means it's an earlier, you know, it came in first. So this should be greater than, I think. Right, lower priority returns true. In this case, if lower priority means later, right? It means later. So count greater than that means later, okay? You know, the bigger the task count number, the later it was created. This thing should return true. So this is the workaround. False. So now they're in the correct order, A, B, and C. Okay. So it's not really a foolproof workaround, sort of workaround, because it's, you know, the task count is linked to the creation time. It's not really linked to the insertion time. Like, I can create 3A first, you know, but it doesn't mean that just because I created 3A first, doesn't mean that I actually inserted 3A first. So this, you know, this is a workaround for this example. Basically, you need some kind of workaround to get this priority queue to work. Okay, that's, by itself, it doesn't work. So that's a workaround. Okay. So unique pointers, so why do we even need them? That's because in C++, the throw keyword can interfere with the pointer delete mechanism. So I'll just start with an example. Create function, any function. F. So I want to display a message. So what? So that's your basic throw. But the thing in C++ is that you can't actually use this exception class as it is, even though, you know, it's got the message inside a what function. So, but because you don't have a constructor. So let's go over to the exception class. Right, so there's no constructor that lets you set the message that's internal to the exception. So I can throw here, you know, exception, but you know I can't do something like this. Fader inside F, which is right. Can't do this. There's no such constructor. So I basically have to derive my own exception object. So my own custom exception object with a message here. Let's go back to the Well, first I need a constructor, so. Then, gonna need the what, right? Oh, the throw means that it doesn't throw any exception, so that's like a misnomer here. C++11 has a different one, so this, you know, this keyword no except, this makes more sense. But currently in my version of Eclipse that doesn't work, so I have to use this one. Just copy it over here. C string. So I'll throw this one instead. Okay. So this doesn't work. Some error messages here. Yeah, so this is actually a typo here. Deprecate it. Have to use const. Should get rid of deprecate. Okay. So yeah, so you have to use const because it's a string. So here's a real error. That one I talk about. I didn't put in a destructor here, I only have a constructor. So they're saying that, you know, the exception, I'm inheriting from exception has this kind of destructor. If you go back to the documentation, it has a destructor, has the throw. And the default destructor is going to be something like this, it doesn't have the throw. So the default destructor is no good, basically I have to copy it over here, make my own destructor. Well, actually it doesn't do anything, so I'll just blank, and yeah, I change the name to that. Right, just, yeah, make your own empty destructor that has this throw keyword. So now it builds. So it doesn't do anything, just, you know, main calls ff throws, just to see that this actually works. So I have this, right? So that's what. Now, to show the mechanism, to show that, you know, this throw keyword will interfere with the pointer delete mechanism, I have to create a new class, my class. Doesn't do anything, it just has a destructor. Comment this out, so right, so normally you know, you have a new and delete pair like this, so this thing new and then delete, and delete, I know delete actually, the way I know delete actually happens is because delete calls the destructor which triggers this line. Okay, but if I have a throw here, this delete won't be called, so this memory is not deallocated. Just to show, right? Now an exception can actually pop up any time, right? It won't look like this, right? It's gonna have like something like this, and you know, this G is gonna throw an exception, and if F doesn't catch it, or, you know. So in general, I'm just saying that if you simply allocate a pointer, there's no guarantee that it's gonna go to delete, because exception can happen from an underlying function. So when this throw happens, when exception occurs and the exception is not caught, the stack will unwind. So this, though, if you declare something on a stack, the destructor will be called. Like, if you declare a class like this, if you declare a class on a stack, the destructor will be called. I should put an N. Right. So warning unused variable. Okay. So the idea is that the idea behind the unique pointer or any other managed pointer is that you're putting your pointer, you're doing your allocation inside of, you know, inside of my class. So inside of the class, they're allocating a pointer, and then inside the destructor of the class, they're gonna have something like here, deallocate the pointer here. So that's the idea. So that way it guarantees that the the delete will get called, the memory gets deallocated. Because even if an exception occurs, you know, the destructor is always going to happen, and then inside the destructor, they delete the pointer. So get used to use the unique pointer, you need to include memory, and that's and the syntax is like this. It's actually PTR. Now this actually won't work, so I'm just gonna do this. Because in Eclipse, in my version of Eclipse, currently doesn't work. I'll show you. So simple unique pointer cannot be solved. Just go online, search for unique pointer. Cannot be resolved. So there's some solution online. It has to do with the Eclipse support for C++11. So they have to do this thing, experimental. They have to add in this thing. So rather not do anything experimental. But unique pointer is in the standard, so show unique. Right, there's actually, it's in memory, it's unique pointer, it's actually part of standard, so it works in Windows, so I'll just go over Windows. Right. So output error, no error. So this actually does work in Windows. Now to use that, do this class p new. Oh wait, yeah, because that would be class. Unique pointer is really a class where inside the class you have the pointer, right? So new my class, yeah. So p is actually an object on the stack, and so if you run this, so no error. Drag it down here. So if you run this, even though the throw happens, the failure inside F, you know, the throw happens, but the pointer still gets deallocated, right? Because you see the destructor being printed out. Okay. Oh, and just to show that it can be used as a pointer. So it's print Xiao hello world. So it's you know, you can use it just like a pointer. You know, the arrow symbol here. Right. So you can print. This is the print function, printing hello world. But the thing with the unique pointer is that you can't assign it to anything else. So let me p2 equals p. Right, the error list is gonna show well, this is kinda wordy. If I try to build it, get a short error list. Yeah. Cannot access private member declared inside unique pointer. So for you, when you create a unique pointer p, you can't assign it to another unique pointer. Basically, they make the assignment operator or whatever, they make it private so that you can't assign this. Now the reason is that if you have two pointers, this is a simple class, right? So if you have two pointers, you might end up deleting it twice or something like that. Like, you know, when do you call delete, right? So the solution in this case is that the way this unique pointer solved this problem is they let you create only one instance of the pointer. and you can't copy this pointer to another pointer. So, in summary, the unique pointer solved the memory deallocation problem via two different routes. It guarantees that the memory is deallocated because the unique pointer is an object on the stack. So even if you throw, even if you have an exception from somewhere, the destructor will always get called when the stack unwinds. So that's guaranteed to call delete, because inside a class, you know, inside the destructor of the unique pointer class, they will call delete. And the second problem associated with these managed pointer classes is that how do you make sure that it's only deleted one time, right? You don't want to, if you have two pointers pointing to the same thing, you don't want to delete that memory two times. So the way that this thing solves this problem is by not letting you making any copies. So, you know, there's only one copy. There's only one pointer pointing to my class, this my class object. So then delete only happens one time, it won't happen two times. Okay, so that's the summary for the unique pointer.